So this topic is actually going to be a little far removed from what you saw in the previous sessions. And so I will not actually take a lot of deep dive into what really happens here. But some of the use cases that I'll be providing might be actually useful to the industry. And in general, it will be useful for us to actually look at what is happening in the world of medical sciences, which is concerning the health related to the human beings. So what are the advancements that are happening? And how is it that artificial intelligence and machine learning, so on and so forth, are actually helping the cause for some of the diseases that are actually still prevalent in throughout our mankind, whatever history that we've actually seen. So I will start with this particular thing. So where I would, is it possible for you to identify the man in this picture? Yeah. Yeah, that's actually Sergey Brin, the co-founder of Google. And the person next to him is, I know she's very popular, and she's Angelina Jolie. There is a common thread connecting the two of them, and that is primarily with respect to something that they suffered, and something which was actually kind of witnessing a lot of research in the field of machine learning. If you look at Sergey, way back in 2000s, early 2000s, he had his DNA test done. And what his DNA test actually showed was he had a faulty gene, which was LRRK2, which happened to be diagnosed by his doctors as a DNA which can result in Parkinson's disease. When he actually went ahead to figure out what really is happening, he also had this kind of a problem because his mother and his aunt also had the same gene, and they were also actually suffering from Parkinson's disease. So what he did was he actually took a backseat. He went back to the basics in terms of doing a lot of exercises. He changed his lifestyle, his dietary habits, and right now he's more into yoga, he's more into gymnastics, he's more into swimming, diving, so on and so forth. He's more into caffeine because it seems Parkinson's disease can actually be cured with lots and lots of doses of caffeine. So he's actually changed his lifestyle based on the genomic research and what the technology told him in terms of where he can actually be facing the risk. Next one, Angelina Jolie, is probably more publicized. And she had a problem because her mother died at the age of 56 due to cancer. And when her DNA was again diagnosed, it was actually found out that she had 87% chances of getting breast cancer and 50% chances of actually getting ovarian cancer. What did she do? I mean, she went, she looked at what the researchers and the medical advisors were actually telling her, and she went for surgery, a corrective surgery, to make sure that she doesn't have any probability of suffering from that. So when she went for that, after the surgery, the probability of her getting this particular disease reduced from 87% to 13%. That's the world of medical research, and there is a lot of technological advancements that are happening in this area. And let's take the next few slides. Actually, we'll be walking through what exactly are the trends that are catching up and what exactly are provided by areas like machine learning and Internet of Things. This is the agenda. So I will quickly go into just a quick introduction as to what this means. What we're seeing here is actually the value chain of a pharma industry. So the pharma industry is essentially involved in launching new drugs which can cure new diseases. So this is actually the value chain. I mean, so discovery is where thousands and thousands of molecules are actually discovered by the lab scientists, and we actually see which particular molecule is able to bind well to the target protein which is responsible for the disease. So that essentially is the first phase, which is discovery phase. The development phase is what we call as the clinical trials phase, where the drug is actually administered to multiple human beings, and we test them over phases. I mean, phase one, phase two, and phase three. And what happens is that after the phase three, which is the largest clinical trial that happens across multiple years, we gather data related to whether the drug is really working or not, whether it is safe, whether it is efficacious, whether it is doing what it is promised to be doing, and gather this evidences, and we submit to what we call as the regulatory bodies, which is like the FDA and the EMEA. FDA looks through the data, scans through the data, and sees whether there is any evidence to say that the drug is working. It takes multiple years for FDA to come back. And only after FDA is convinced that this particular is working, drug is working based on the data, FDA approves it for marketing and selling it in the market. That essentially is the value chain. And what we'll be seeing right now is actually more on the discovery and the development phase. That's where the use cases are predominant. So we'll actually focus on these two. Challenges, if you look at it, there is enough evidence in the pharma thing that the drug pipeline is coming down. The research is clearly saying that the pharma's CAGR, the compounded annual growth rate of the pharma companies, has actually fallen from 12% to less than 2% as of the last four, five years. Cost of actually producing drug, it used to be during the 1980s, it used to be about $300 to $400 million. Right now, as we speak right now, it is actually upwards of 2.5 billion USD. That's the amount of investment that the pharma companies have to make to actually bring a drug to the market. And that's where they're looking for some really, really technological support to take them to the next level so they can reduce their cost, they can reduce the time that it takes to actually launch the molecule, and also to make sure that more promise is there in terms of the quality of the drug that is getting administered. So it is time, cost, and quality, all the three parameters have to be looked into from the pharma perspective, and that's where the challenge is coming in. And that's where we are looking up to the industry to actually help. So some of the use cases, this is the slide where I will probably spend some time. So the Internet of Things, we have always been used to taking medicines which are more chemical in nature. And in November 2017, we had something quite drastic happen in this entire medical sciences industry, when the FDA approved a digital pill. Now, a digital pill is something where a sensor is actually attached to a medicine. I mean, your normal medicine that you're having, your Crozin or Calpol, whatever it is, they attached a sensor to that. A sensor was actually the size of a grain of sand. They attached to it and they ingested that particular medicine into the patient's body, and they were trying to actually figure out how the medicine is performing. This particular research was happening for more than 10 years, and FDA was not ready to approve it because it is a different body that is actually getting into your genetic makeup. So it was not very, FDA was actually skimming through lots of records and data to actually do the approval. And finally, after 10 years, they approved this. Why is it so important for us is that this particular medicine, once when we take it inside, the medicine actually, once as it starts activating, getting activated with your stomach fluid, what it does is it starts sending signals to a patch that is installed in your body externally. Once the patch receives a signal from the medicine or the sensor which is ingested, it starts transmitting that to a mobile app. Now what happens is that this particular thing can be very handy for us, because many of the patients who are suffering from mental diseases like depression, dementia, Parkinson's, it is very difficult for them to make them consume the drug periodically. Many times they say that they take the drugs, but they don't even know whether they've consumed or not. So how do the doctors get a feel and comfort that yes, they have actually ingested that particular drug or not? This is one way of actually determining that. And two, the patch that is installed also starts sending data about the physical activity of the patients, the physical parameters like temperature, the pulse rate, so on and so forth, to the mobile app. So it kind of actually gives a holistic information about what the patient is actually doing in terms of taking this data and how his response is to taking this drug. A radically new invention, and this particular mobile app is actually again connected to the cloud, so the healthcare providers can aggregate and find out how the general mass of patients are actually performing with respect to these types of drugs. A new invention. This is actually more than just the current purpose. What it has thrown out is the ability to actually make a digital pill for many other usages as well. November 2017 is a landmark in many ways from that perspective. Second is what the South Korean scientists did. Now, diabetes is a very, very predominant kind of a disease. I mean, many of us actually have our kith and kin suffering from that. And so what the South Korean the scientists have discovered is something quite unique. many of the diabetes patients, they suffer from one of the serious problems where they have to go through finger pricks on a daily basis to test the blood glucose level. And they also have to take some insulin shots in public places, which can be quite painful for them and quite embarrassing. So these South Korean scientists, actually, they have discovered a patch which actually can be installed on your body. And it actually starts sensing the perspiration or the sweat levels from the body. Through that particular the sweat level concentrations, it sends again a signal back to a mobile device, which calculates the blood glucose level based on the sweat concentration. Now, based on the blood glucose level, if it is able to determine that the levels are very high, it sends a signal back to the patch saying that, you know what, I mean, you need to perhaps give more insulin to the patient's body because the sugar level is actually very high. And what the patch does is it has a series of micro needles, micro syringes, which are so harmless in nature. So when they inject that particular insulin into the body, the patients don't even realize that it's seamlessly getting injected. So they don't even have to take the syringe. The micro syringes are automatically ingesting that particular medicine into the body. So a very important thing, the research is still going on, FDA has still not approved it, but it's going to take years for this to happen. But we are seeing potentially, maybe in a few years down the lane, some such particular advancements are going to come in to help us out with solving some of the serious problems like diabetes. Very important for us. And Blue Sky is again a Pfizer initiative. Pfizer is one of the top three pharmaceuticals in the world. And they have collaborated with IBM Watson to kind of come out with a new way of monitoring the patients. So clinical trials typically have patients getting administered with drugs. We periodically figure out how the patients are responding when the patients visit the site. So what we do in this case is that they did not want it to be episodic in nature. They wanted it to be a continuous monitoring, 24/7 monitoring, where they created a research center in and around the New York City, where this particular research center was nothing but a network of interconnected sensors, where the patients were housed for a predetermined period of time. So what these sensors were doing is it was continuously monitoring the patient's sleeping pattern, the cognitive skills, the motor functions, the sleeping patterns, and how they are responding to the drug that was actually getting administered to them. So what it gave them was a continuous stream of data as to how the patients are actually responding to the molecule that is getting tested. A very important use case. Again, if you look at the common thread across all the three use cases that we talked about, is the proliferation of data. And that is where the medical field right now is still not ready to actually accept this much volume of data, and that's where the demand for data scientists is very, very high in this particular category. Unlike the other industries like banking and financials, where significant amount of investments and research has already happened, this is one area where we have a lot of data coming in. But do we have enough expertise to actually look into this data and come out with the different algorithms? The answer is no. We still can actually do a lot more, and we are waiting for this data proliferation to happen. It is already happening in a lot of segments, and it will continue to happen. Coming to the other area, which is the machine learning, I had actually talked about the case with respect to genomics, Angelina Jolie and Sergey Brin. So this particular area is where there is a lot of research that is happening. A lot of machine learning algorithms are actually coming into play. If you look at the gene, typically there is a lot of confusion as to how to interpret that. But a simple analogy for gene is it is like a book that carries information about a particular human being. So typically in a book you have the sentences, the lines, the words, the letters, they're all actually kind of organized in a particular sequence. Similarly, the genes actually carry a lot of information which are kind of arranged in a particular sequence. And the sequence is actually, it can actually go to about 3 billion pairs. So that's the volume of data that we look at, and it is there in each and every cell that a human being carries. Now, if you tamper with your book, let's say your page gets torn or you actually have water spilled on some of the pages, it kind of, that particular page gets kind of smeared and you will not be able, that becomes faulty in nature. You will not be able to make use of that page. Similarly, when the genes get these kinds of distortions, that is what we call as genetic mutants, the mutant variant gene. And that, over a period of time, we have actually evaluated and we figured out it is this particular mutant gene which is responsible for a lot of ailments like cancer, some of the mental related data, the diseases like Parkinson's, so on and so forth. So that particular research has actually been aided a lot by machine learning. Two use cases here are with respect to CRISPR genetic editing, where scientists have right now figured out where the faulty gene is, and they are trying to actually edit the gene so that they could make out if there is any positive response after the gene editing happens. So CRISPR is one particular company which is in its advanced level of research with respect to genetic editing. They use a lot of algorithms related to supervised learning in actually getting this done. And the other one is also to figure out patterns among patients. So we typically have a lot of patients suffering from cancer, typical population which participates in trial. We are having reams and reams of data with respect to them. We are trying to actually do unsupervised learning to figure out if there's any patterns that are available in this genetic makeup of these patients. Another important area where the use case is actually proving to be very, very useful. And the problem here is that current statistical models are pretty much confined to megabytes and perhaps at gigabytes of data. That's the level of the research that is happening in statistics with respect to clinical research. But machine learning actually gives us the opportunity to elevate it to terabytes and petabytes. So that's one area where it is happening. C-disc mapping is a billion-dollar opportunity for India. A lot of clinical research work that happens out of India, especially in Bangalore and Hyderabad, has got to do with C-disc mapping. So typically, a pharma company works in a very isolated type of manner. I mean, they have their own standards, their own nomenclature and terminology. And when this data gets submitted to FDA for approval, it becomes very difficult for FDA to interpret and figure out what this data means. So FDA has come out with a standard terminology which needs to be followed by all the pharma companies. So that is what is called a C-disc mapping. So while submitting it to the regulatory body, they need to convert their non-standard data into standard format. It is not easy because it actually contains data about thousands and thousands of patients. It actually has a lot of data points. I mean, each patient's data will be about hundreds and hundreds of data points. So all those things need to be converted. It takes typically for one study, one clinical trial, it can take anywhere between 3 months to 4 months. And here, machine learning algorithms are coming in to read this particular mapping between the source and the target variable. And based on the predictive accuracy, machine learning algorithms themselves are actually completing 80% of the mapping, so that only the 20% of non-standard kind of mapping is what requires human intervention. Another significant advancement that are happening in the form of standardization. Third element is, again, so real world evidence is a trend which is catching up very fast in pharma. If I have to draw an analogy here as well, it is kind of, synonymous to what a cricketer does in the nets. So typically when we look at a cricketer, he practices hours and hours in the nets. And whether it's the batting or the bowling, he actually tries to actually play all variety of shots to kind of hone his skills with respect to batting. But you look at a typical match situation, when he enters the stadium to bat, whatever he has done, whatever homework he has done that particular day in the nets doesn't really matter much, because the situation could be like where he's actually walking into with millions of fans supporting him, and there's a lot of expectations. And there could also be a situation where the bowlers on the other side, especially if it happens to be Australians, a lot of sledging. And with all those kinds of problems, he's actually walking in, let's say the situation is 10 for 4. What is going on in his mind is completely different from what he's practiced on the net. So the real world situation can actually be far different from what your net practice situation is. So a drug similarly goes through the same kind of pathway. So a clinical trial is like a net practice. But when the actual match is what the real world evidence is all about, that is when the drug, after getting approved, when it gets launched, when it starts getting administered to a larger audience, the way it behaves can be vastly different, because it depends on the age, it depends on the gender, it depends on the race, the concomitant medications that the particular patient is taking. So it throws open a huge, it's a deluge of data that we have to actually take into consideration. pharma companies are actually started looking into this data to see if there are any clues or any benefits that the drug can actually potentially bring in to other particular diseases. And that's where this particular thing comes in. Lots of use cases. One of them is actually the chart abstraction, where the nurses, they typically go through, read through physician's notes. They take a sample. I mean, the physician's note, typically the doctor's notes, can run through pages for multiple patients. So a nurse is supposed to read at least a few of them and convert them into structured data, into something, into transcribing them into some kind of software. So this particular thing is currently getting automated, and it is actually, there are NLP languages which are looking into the physician notes and automatically converting them into structured text. A very important use case for us. Again, with respect to the other thing is with the supervised learning and unsupervised learning. The traditional models of statistical thing that is happening in pharma, the last two, three centuries, if you look at it, we have been doing a lot of statistical analysis to figure out whether the drug is indeed working or not. So it is not just a clinical assessment, it's a statistical assessment. So this has been going on for many decades in the pharma world. So the p-value finally determines whether the particular drug is efficacious or not. So how are we doing that? It actually takes care of one or two variables here and there, and we try to model that and see whether the factor is actually having any positive response on the model. That typically happens in a traditional environment. So with the advent of machine learning, we now have hundreds of variables, thousands of factors can be modeled in with 1 million or more than 1 million type of data points to actually run your algorithms through. So with that kind of a potential, we will be able to figure out which particular factor is having a determining effect on the efficacy of a particular drug. A huge, huge advancement. We are still, this is particularly in its nascent stage. FDA is taking all the steps to make sure that these kinds of algorithms are being accepted by that. So this is happening, and we still do not have the skill sets, at least from India and the global level, to get into this kind of paradigm. But if it happens, it's going to be a huge bonanza for the talent that we have in India. So with this, I mean, I will conclude my short speech on what exactly the medical research is actually benefiting from. Typically, if you look at it, I mean, there is a Greek word which is called as notus, which means known. So it actually stands for the English word known. And it branches off into two elements. I mean, if it is on the positive side, if a guy is actually well known, it is called, I mean, it is noted. So noted actually comes from notice. And the other side, if it is not known for good things, or if it's known for all the wrong reasons, then it is actually called notorious. Both these words actually come from the same root word called notice. And if you typically look at it, I mean, this is the 1970s, 80s Bollywood script, right? So two sons, one is actually a policeman and the other one becomes a smuggler. That kind of a scenario. It is possible. So if you look at the use cases of predictive analytics or machine learning, across the board, I mean, whether it is medical research or any other field like retail, there are some positives that we have seen. There are some areas where it has proved to be negative. I mean, we know the US election 2016, what happened? There are a lot of algorithms that predicted who's going to win, but we all know who finally landed up in. And but there are areas like Moneyball. You would have seen Brad Pitt's movie about how we use that in baseball to successfully push the Oakland A's to win championships, at least getting closer to the championships, Morgan House of Cards. So lots of things are happening where it has been positively used, and there are some areas where it has not been very positive in nature. Similarly, the medical research field is also going through some such challenges because we are at our infancy. There will be areas where I'm sure over a period of time there will be more benefits than the demerits that we actually saw. So good or bad, this is one area where the idea has actually arrived in the medical research at the right time. So with that, with this, I would like to conclude my session, and I'll probably have my questions for the roundtable later on. Thanks for the opportunity.